someone walking through a thorny path, a forest full of thorny branches. That's the German way of how we celebrate joy, right? George is sick of it. He said, bring the happy music out, right? Yes. What on earth are we going to do with Mary? I mean, the Protestants, they just made tabula rasa and said, we don't do Mariology, right? We believe in God, in Jesus. We can go straight up to heaven with him. We don't need this Mary girl. And then we have to pray through Mary to get to God. Just forget about all that adoration stuff. And then there's the other part, the other crew of us, and they're running this social actions, you know, songs. Have you ever heard the Magnificat? That's what it's called, Mary's song. Being preached through by all these radical preachers, right? They say, oh, this is good stuff. We can use that right now for calling out the revolution. Because it says there, you know, he's throwing down the ones who are powerful from their thrones. He lifts up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, sent the rich away empty. And there's a huge tradition out there from the peasants in Nicaragua and in the Philippines, all the basic liberation celebration theology communities. They say, that's it. God is turning it upside down. And whoever is rich is going to have a hard time. And whoever is poor is going to be elevated. And it's going to be beautiful. That's what we need. Someone in our get-together on Thursday evenings, you have to come sometime. We have a lot of fun. He said, I'll better don't show up today, right? Because I'm on the other side. By the way, all of us are on the other side, right? We're the powerful one. We're the rich ones. Out of my faucet comes water every morning when I turn it on. Guess what, right? I have heat in my parsonage. Thank you, trustees, right? My refrigerator is full. I even know where I get my money from when I retire one day. And so on and on and on and on. What do we do with Mary's song? Is it really what it was meant there, that it says, well, all the rich will go out empty, and we need to, you know, almost adore the poor? I had a conversation with my colleague, which I'm on the training with together. She's a pastor at a Methodist church over there in Palm Beach in California. So, you know, average income, we're not going there. I said, what are you going to do with this preaching on Sunday? And she came back and she said, well, you just have to tell them. You have to lay it out there and say, God is especially close to the poor. He favors the ones who are on the fringes. He loves them a little bit more. And I said, that can't be, Jane. I love a God who even cares for me and for you too, right? And then we get into this romanticization and saying, oh, how sweet it is to have on Christmas Eve, we're all going to go to the soup kitchen and cook there. Whatever you do, you're doing an amazing job, don't get me wrong. But it's not beautiful there, is it? It's a scandal that there are people that we have to make a Christmas party with on Thursday when we go out there, right, for Camp Hope Tuesday. It's not beautiful. Why would God be especially so close to the ones there? There must be a different understanding of Mary's song, of the Magnificat that we just heard here and that she's saying. I mean, it's a teenage girl song. Let's just lay it out there. And you know, teenagers, they go through these things. You know what she just had gone through, right? If you go back a little bit in your Bible, you understand where that song comes from. That she was there in her house, getting ready, all the romantic ideas. I'm going to be married to Joseph. And this is how we're going to do the wedding, you know, white roses maybe for the wedding and have it all together. And while she's there, all pure in her own little room, there's a stranger in her room, Virgin Mary. And that's a shock in itself. And that guy, Angel Gabriel, is talking to her and giving her some news that's going to ruin her career completely, right? Turning it upside down right there. Holy Mary, yes. What would you do if you got a message like that? If there was suddenly someone in your room and is laying it there and said, by the way, Mary, you have found favor in God's presence. And this is what's going to happen to you. That's not a smooth like transition for us. We're used to the story and say, okay, we know that. For her. Maybe that's why she wrote that song. Maybe she's all puzzled, you know. She's packing up as fast as she can. First she argues a little bit, and then she's going to go somewhere else, going to see her relative, probably cousin, right, Elizabeth, up there on the mountain hills. She needs to get out of town because this is, I mean, interesting. And then she's finding herself sitting there with a barren, older, elderly lady who never was supposed to have any children, who's pregnant, 6 months, Elizabeth. And here is a teenage virgin pregnant. And here is an older lady pregnant, 6 months. And they're sitting together, and that's when that song comes out. No wonder they're coming up with a song like that, Magnificat, right? Yikes. It's one of my favorite songs, so don't even think I'm going to put it into an ignorant, ironic way. What is the message? What on earth can we do with Mary? If it's not just the naive, well, all the poor are good now and all the rich, they're going to get punished. What if it's not just Mariology and Holy Mary, help us sinners? We need to go back to the moment when Gabriel, the angel, the messenger, meets Mary. And there is a wonderful communication, a conversation, very intense going on there. The first time the angel Gabriel breaks the news to Mary, Mary is right on spot. She's not shy. She is asking, well, wait a minute. She's in shock. She's scared to death, and I would be too, probably. But she's there, and she's asking, number one, how? And why? Why and how should that happen? And here comes the important part. Watch this. So the angel is answering her and say, you found favor in God's eyes, and he will come, and his power, the power of the Almighty God, will overshadow you, and the Spirit of the Lord will be upon you. That is very, very important. Again, the power of the Almighty God will overshadow you, and the presence of His Spirit will be with you. And that's how it's going to work. And impulsive teenager Maria is turned inside out at that moment from complete fear. First she says, fear not, we're good, right? You're safe. Turning around, and her answer to this thing is, here I am. We heard that a couple times the last couple of weeks, right? Here I am, Lord. I am the Lord's servant. Keep that in mind. Mary, from who, wow, why, and it can't happen because it cannot happen, to here I am. I am the Lord's servant. And from there she starts moving. There is a liberation, a transformation happening right there in that intimate conversation between angel Gabriel and here little teenage girl Mary. From being completely shocked and in fear and no, 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 that cannot be, to here I am, I'm the Lord's servant. And that is a liberation that is carrying through, and she's bringing it back into a song that we have here in front of us. A song that she's creating while she's there, young, beautiful, energized, with her cousin sitting there, Elizabeth. And now suddenly she can say, my soul, we left that out in your reading, magnifies the Lord. That's the first part of the Magnificat of Mary's song. Magnifying means making bigger, remember? I have these wonderful colleagues on Thursday night and said, do you have a magnifying glass at home? And they all nodded, yeah, so they brought me that because they keep their word. You know, you have one of these at home? This is a very old one, I have to be very careful with it. Or this one. Do you know when you magnify something, you can see it better, right? But it's also when you magnify it, your own eye gets bigger too. You want to see it? Oh, it always works. It worked with my kids. It works with you guys too. My eyes get bigger too. Try it at home. Mary, in the middle of the shock and saying, here I am, I'm the Lord's servant, is getting her eyes not only clearer to see what she's supposed to see, but her own eyes are getting bigger. Wow. You know, the big eyes of the children on Christmas Eve or on the Christmas morning. Wow. This thing. That's what's happening to this shocked teenage girl right there who's exposed to a new dimension that she has never even anticipated that would happen to her. Right there in the making. Wow. My soul magnifies the Lord, and I rejoice in the Lord my Savior. Have you ever had a moment when you just want to magnify the Lord because your own eyes get bigger and say, I can't believe it, what he just did in my life. And she has no clue what she's talking about. All she knows is the Almighty, his power will overshadow me. Wow. And the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Wow. And now I can go and see and go with the flow, whatever God has laid out for me. Here I am. I'm the Lord's servant. How on earth will she know what's going to happen next, right? That's the beginning of liberation, of a naive young woman who's turning it upside down, who got turned upside down in her own expectation. This is what's going to happen next, and then this is what's going to happen next. She's right there, waiting for birth. No clue, right? You know where her story goes from there. Wow. If she goes through what every mother and every grandparent will go through, she will lose her child, right? On a little hike to Jerusalem. Where's my child? She will get despised. Her own son, listen to that one. If you go into the sad mode over Christmas and say, he could have at least sent an email or called, right? Merry Christmas. If you have one of those somewhere in your family patterns, Mary went through that too, right? Remember when the brothers and Mary would come close to Jesus one time? And he said, who's my mother? Who's my brother? No time. No time. Wow. My soul magnifies the Lord. Oh, I'm the Lord's servant. The next time we really hear from her, and she's the only character, by the way, in the New Testament, is when Mary is standing there watching her own son getting a beautiful crown on his head. A beautiful, full of, guess what? Thorns. And she's going to be the one who's standing under that cross, that cross. And she's going to be the one who's going to hear the cry of her own son, not running away. And watching him, witness of him getting murdered there, cruelly. Wow. Magnify the Lord. She's going to be the one who's going to go to that grave because she knows what we're supposed to do. And she's going to see an empty grave. Wow. And here's the best part about it. She's going to be one of the ones, Acts 1. When everything's over, after Easter, when we're going to the story of Acts, when the disciples are all put together, they're in a locked up room in the second level, trying to figure out what on earth are we going to do now? Career is over, discipleship's gone, the whole thing broke down. And the disciples were in that room, second floor, upper room. And there was Mary with them. I didn't notice that until I read it again. Wow. And what is happening right there in that upper room? The Holy Spirit abides among everybody, including this woman who started as a teenage girl, naive as she says, here I am, I'm the Lord's servant, still on the road, trying to make sense to what has happened, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon all of them, including Mary. Transformation has happened. It's still the right news. The Lord is the Savior, and the one who wore the crown is the one who carries the victory. He didn't get defeated there on the cross. That's my son. I am bringing good news to the ones. And suddenly it makes sense, and that's why the song makes sense for all of us, because it doesn't just say, well, all the rich, they're going down, and all the poor are going up. It says there, the haughty ones, I learned a new word on Thursday, it's a good word, haughty. The haughty ones, they will go down. That means the ones, the rulers, the powerful, the rich ones, who are ruling this earth as if it belonged to themselves, as if they were God, which is not the truth. They didn't design it, they didn't architect it, they didn't have the whole creation together until the kingdom of God will be fulfilled. The haughty ones will go down, and the ones who are humble, they will be lifted up. And if I read that, then it makes sense for all of us. Then it doesn't matter so much, well, it matters, how much wallet, how much money is in my wallet, and how much is on my bank account, but the attitude of how I carry the responsibility that comes with it in my own walk with the Savior. Because if he says, all the ones who are calling themselves servants of me, here I am, serving the Lord, I am still on. I can still be called on that path like Mary did, all the roller coaster part from A to B to C, and still the Spirit of the Lord will be upon me. Does that make sense? That does not mean we're calling out the revolution. That does not mean that we can say anymore, well, all the poor and all the uneducated and all the ones on the fringes, if they were just in charge, we'd be good. May God forbid that, right? We need people who know what they're doing, who are servants, who know with their assets, with whatever they're doing, that they're still serving under the Lord's, the Spirit's guidance, so that the power of the omnipotent God will overshadow every step of every person in this room and everywhere outside too. Then the Magnificat, wow, is not just for the poor and the ones who have nothing and the ones who walk in the dirt, but it's for everybody who needs that servant spirit new. And it's preached as much as it is preached for Palm Beach out there in California, as it's preached in our neighborhood. And we will be preached in the apartment complexes on Telshire, as much as in my own family picture. Here I am, Lord. I'm a servant. I want to be under your guidance, humble, and take the haughtiness, is that a word, away from me, so that I stand with 2 feet on the ground, and that I accept and understand that you are the Savior, and you're that reason for me to walk this path. And then I can move mountains with and through your guidance. If Mary was able to do, I'll do it too. Not knowing what's ahead of me, and you don't know either. Someone sent me a beautiful picture this week. He said, check this out. Do we have it on the slide? The Rictory wreath, right? That's what it is. The wreath that we have on our heads when we think we did it, has a structure in it, a very particular structure. And that structure, the whole design, was made by the one who fought for it, who got killed by it, and who turned the world upside down. And through him, all our walks through thorn forests, will not just go on and on and on and on and on. But there will be something in the end which is called the walk of roses. Suddenly, when the Lord will take over, all of us are called into a servanthood, knowing if he takes the victory, we can just say, here I am. My soul magnifies the Lord. And I rejoice in that Savior who carried and paid for it with his life. And so I want to finish this up. My sad German Advent song didn't finish there. There's a third verse to it. Listen up, read along. Lord, I know that you have a path for us, that you give us better understanding, that you don't take sides, that even if we walk through the walks, the forests full of thorns, we know one day when we're there, and Advent has happened, your arrival, there will be roses on the thorns. We will carry the victory wreath, and we will know and be knowledgeable about the structure inside of it. We know that we can do nothing, but we know that you take down the haughty ones, the ones who abuse power for their own benefit. And you take them off and say, I am the Lord. With my almighty power, I will overshadow all of you, saints in the making. So when you walk the forests of thorns, you will not fall down. You will catch your breath, and you will see the roses of my love blooming. And you will know that I will make it with you from birth to walking the path of discipleship, to standing under the cross, under an empty grave, and finally meeting you in the community of saints where the Holy Spirit, Pentecost, will abide in us. And then you will tell us again, do not fear, I got you. And together, it'll be an amazing arrival of the Messiah, the one who paid for it, the one who will be magnified, and my soul will rejoice in the Lord, my Savior. Prepare us, Lord, better and better. In your holy name we pray. Amen.